Okay, so the goal of today is to end the proof of the short basis theorem. That I started yesterday, and so let me just recall the statement and where we went. So the theorem says that there exists some constant, positive constant, universal positive constant, such that two things occur. If M is a Riemannian manifold with a Ricci curvature bounded below, and if the fundamental group of this manifold is generated by loops of length less than R, then it's also generated by less than C and R such generators, so less than C and R loops of length less than R, okay? And the second point in the theorem was that you can find some Q, some other point in not too far away from P, such that any short basis at Q contains at most C and R element. Okay, and it is the part two which we were proving yesterday, and the argument was by contradiction. Okay, and hello Laurent. So, so yeah.
The manifold has it assumed to be compact or complete or.
For this statement, just assume that M is complete, right?
Okay.
No compactness assumption. Okay. So think of a manifold which can be non-compact, but you assume that the fundamental group is generated by loops of length bounded. Okay. It's a kind of co-compactness. I mean, okay, it replaces all this kind of assumption. Okay, so the proof. So let's just assume R equal 2 for simplicity, and the proof was by contradiction. And by contradiction, it. So we worked a little bit and proved that it was we reduce the problem to rule out contradicting sequence of the following type. So a sequence of Riemannian manifold with Ricci bounded below, but In the first reduction, we had done already a rescaling, so we can assume that this contradicting sequence has Ricci curvature almost non-positive, and such that there exists some QI in the ball of radius one. Around, such that for any QI in the ball of radius 1 around PI, there exist 3 to the I, at least 3 to the I, short generators. At QI of length less than 4. Okay? This was what we have done yesterday. So sorry for the one who weren't here yesterday. Okay, so and of course we can also assume my usual compactness theorem that MI PI Gromov-Hausdorff converge. Gromov-Hausdorff converge to some limit metric space. Okay, and then we had two steps in the argument to construction process. The first amount was the following. So if there is some such a contradicting sequence, if there exists such a so let's let's call this property star. The fact that there exist at least 3 to the h short generators at QI such that the 4, okay, of length less than 4. It is a 4 here. So if there exists such a contradicting sequence converging to xp infinity, then there exists another one converging to Rk, where k was the dimension of x. Okay, and this we have shown yesterday. Okay, completely. And the second point was to show that if you have such a new sequence, a new contradicting sequence converging to the Euclidean space, then you can dilate again in order to increase the dimension of the limit. Okay, and then this will allow to do some induction argument on the dimension of x. Okay, so if there exists MI PI converging to RK and satisfying star, then there exists another sequence M prime P prime converging to RK cross Z with diameter of Z positive. Okay, and the two things allow us to inductively construct if there is some contradicting sequence. Using alternatively those two things, you can show that at the end, you can find a contradicting sequence which converges to Rn, n being the dimension of all manifold, and then there were an easy argument to rule out this case, okay? And this was a contradiction, okay? And so, okay? So yesterday, I finished right after this this part, and I wanted I would like now to show the second part. Okay, so one has such a contradicting sequence. Okay, and we want to rescale again in order to make raise some kind of fiber here, and the idea is the following. So it's the same idea as we used already. So start with the Chigurh-Colding theorem, which says that if you have such a sequence, so I forgot to write down that the Ricci curvature is almost non-negative here. So the Chigurh-Colding theorem apply and give you a bunch of harmonic function. Okay, so you have some harmonic function from Mi to Rk harmonic such that the gradient of these functions are uniformly bounded. And another property which says that those functions behave like Euclidean coordinates, namely the fact that the average over all balls of radius r, at least one of the following functions, so the sum over j and k of the scalar product of the gradient of b, bg I, bg b, b k I, minus delta gk, plus the sum over g of the Hessian of all those functions, bj I to the square, tends to zero. Okay? And so the idea is to use a product lemma that we proved during the lecture, and to renormalize this MI in such a way that it converges to something larger, and then we use now the trick about a maximal function. Of R.D. Littlewood, which allows, as we already see, so that there exists some point Zi not far from Pi, so in the ball of radius say a quarter around Pi, such that. So if I write this function here, the sum and the norm of the Hessian as usual as Hi, such that the average of this function tends to zero for all balls of positive radius. And then you can apply the product lemma. Remember, there was this subtlety which was to pass from radius larger than one to any radius, and this was this localization things related to RD maximal function of RD Littlewood, and then you can apply the product lemma, and we come up with the fact that you can normalize. So then, for any mu I tending to infinity, if you look at mu I mi, pointed out at this good point, then it will converge to rk cross z, where the fiber z depends on the choice of the rescaling sequence, of course, and now the goal is to find a good rescaling factor such that the diameter of Z is positive. Okay? So What the product lemma tells us is that for any rescaling, I will have such a convergence. And now I want to find the right one which will allow me to have a positive diameter. And OK, so and now what do we have? So if we look at the manifold Mi around Zi, and if I look at short generators, for points which are nearby the eye. So I will use the same trick as yesterday. Okay, so I will renormalize MI slowly in such a way that one has many short generators, many small short generators. So what we know is that for any yi in the ball around zi of radius a quarter, then if I look at the length of short generators, what we will have is the following picture. So if I look at 4 divided by lambda I, if lambda I tends to infinity slowly, as yesterday, I'm pretty sure that, I don't know if you remember the argument, but I can choose lambda I sufficiently slow in such a way that the number of generators here is polynomial, not more than polynomial. Here, you have at least 3 to the I, so that here you have at least 2 to the I generators. Okay? And the difference with the previous argument is that I can arrange myself. So one can choose lambda I slow, meaning less than I, in order to make this argument here. I can choose lambda I going to infinity slowly in such a way that there exists for zi one short generator of length exactly 4 divided by lambda I. Okay, it's not difficult to do that. Okay, so and such that there exists some generator gamma I at zi with the length of gamma I exactly 4 divided by lambda I. Okay, and therefore, when I rescale by lambda I, if I look now lambda I mi zi, so we know that it converges to rk cross z. Okay, but we also know that. Okay, we know this, but we also know that. In this manifold, there is one loop. Now there is one loop of length lambda I times 4 divided by lambda I. So 4, okay? 4. For the rescale metric, one has one generator at zi which has this property, okay? And the fact that, so this means that, so now the ID roughly is the following. So you have this space which converges to this, and we want to show that Z has positive diameter. So Z is not a point. And the ID is that since I have some element in the group which makes something in the universal cover, it will move points, then the diameter cannot be zero. Okay? This is the ID. So the ID is the following. The fact that there is one generator which moves, which is long enough, which has positive fixed positive length, implies that the diameter of Z equal is positive. And let me just explain why. How does it go? Okay, so let me prove this statement. Okay, so it's pretty obvious, but it's not that obvious. Okay, so let me just do it in some detail. So look at what we have. So okay, so. Look at the universal cover of MI. So what we have is the universal cover acted on by the fundamental group of MI, pointed at some lift here, and this will okay. So and this covers the rescale manifold. So So this is just a quotient. Okay? And this upstairs this action of the group on the universal cover converges to so this converges sorry so this converges to RK product Z. Okay? And upstairs it converges to RK cross maybe there is some other lines by almost splitting there might be other lines cross some other compact set cross Z infinite twiddle. Okay? So and with a group, sorry, the group there is a, some kind of some limit group of this action in such a way that this space is just a quotient of this larger space by G. Okay? So one has this very simple situation. So one has this sequence of manifold which converges to this. So of course we can assume here that Z is compact. I recall you that what we want to show is that is that the diameter of Z is positive, so if Z is not compact, I have nothing to do. So I suppose that Z is compact, and I want to show that the diameter is strictly positive. So I have this situation, okay? And so this situation is a quotient of what is going on at the, in the universal cover. So one has this convergence, okay, here, where G is a closed subgroup of the isometric group of these whole things, okay? And so since the RK stay downstairs, then G acts trivially on RK, so I could add this. So that I can say, in some sense, that RL cross K divided by G is equal to Z. Okay? Okay, so and now I want to show that this guy has positive diameter. And I will conclude this by a simple geometric lemma. Which is the following. So it's a nice lemma about convergence of action. Okay, the lemma says the following. So there are two parts. One is the following. So take any sequence of metric space acted on by some group which converges to a limiting action. Okay. So all these are metric spaces. Okay, don't write it. And suppose also that for two number A and B, the group gamma of A plus B, I will define it in 1 second. So let me write it down and explain what it means. So what I mean by gamma of R, so when G acts on some metric space, I will call G of R, so with some base point somewhere, I will call G of R the group, the subgroup of G which moves P, generated by element which moves P less than R, like in the Margulis groups. So it's a group generated by gamma, by G, in G, such that the distance between P and GP is less than R. So GR is a group generated by element which move not too much. And so here I have a sequence of group action converging to some group action, and I assume that at the limit, then the group generated by element which move not more than some constant is some number is constant on some interval. Okay, the group doesn't change. Okay, this subgroup of gamma infinity doesn't change. Okay, on all this interval for all value r in between a and b. For all r between a and b, the group is the same. This group is the same. Okay, then. The same is true, there is some kind of continuity. So then there exists some epsilon I tending to zero, such that for any R in A plus epsilon I, B minus epsilon I, then gamma I of R equal gamma I of A plus B over 2. Okay? So the same thing occurs for gamma I with some kind of on some smaller interval, but not that smaller. Okay. So this is one first part of the lemma. So this is just so I won't prove this. It is just a trivial consequence of definition of converging action on metric spaces. And the second part of the lemma is the following. So assume that, so I will write it more specifically in this situation. So I have mi qi, which converge to rk cross z, so this was a z, sorry. Okay, and we assume that gamma I act on mi twiddle zi twiddle, and that this action converges to. So okay, so I should write. So I look at mi twiddle gamma I z e twiddle, which converges to RK. So you have, okay, RK cross RL cross K cross Z twiddle infinite, and with an action of some G. Okay, and then and with quotient RK cross Z. And then the second statement says that. So I suppose that this is compact. So this has some kind of diameter. So the claim is that gr for any two positive numbers r and r prime, which are not only positive but larger than two times the diameter of k, then gr equal gr prime. Okay. Okay. So this is. So how to conclude from this? How to conclude from this? And then maybe I will explain the second part or skip it. I don't know. How to conclude? So if the diameter of Z, so I want to show that in our situation, the diameter of Z is not zero. So if the diameter of Z would be zero, then one would know that all those groups would coincide. Okay, so it would imply that G of R equal G of R prime for any R and R prime positive. Okay. And then I apply, so this is by the second part of the lemma. And then by the first part of the lemma, it would imply. Sorry? Okay. So here?
No,
So it's strictly larger, two times the diameter of Z. Yeah, right. Thank you. So if R and R prime are strictly larger than two times the diameter, then one has this, okay? Okay. And then, by the first part of the lemma, the same is true. So the same is true for the same is true for gamma I, and then I can find some sequence epsilon I tending to zero, such that one has that gamma I of epsilon I is gamma I of R, okay? For example, gamma I of 4, okay? But it's not true because in this element I have gamma I, which is a short generator, which move exactly here, and this short generator cannot be in the group generated by element which displace less than 4. Okay, so this ends the proof, and maybe I let you this as an exercise. It's completely straightforward. It's just think a little, and it's not difficult. So the first part is a continuity of the action, and the second part is just it's just a picture, okay? Yeah. Yeah. So when you have a Gromov Hausdorff limit of a sequence of connected Riemann manifolds, the limit is connected. Yeah. Exactly. So it's good question. Yeah. So it implies that it is a length space also. So you have curves, and then the dimension is positive. Sure. Okay. So is there any question about this? And if there are no, I will jump to the proof or sketch of proof of the theorem of Kapovich-Wilking. So I will be okay, more sketchy than I thought, but I'm sorry for that. So the proof of the short basis theorem is up to very small details complete. And now I would like to restate the theorem of Kapovich-Wilking. So it says the following. It says that there exists some universal constant, C of n, and another positive constant, epsilon of n. So this is a kind of Margulis constant. This is a bound on the index, such that if M is any Riemannian manifold with lower Ricci bound, then the subgroup gamma epsilon of P, which is a group generated by those elements in pi 1 of, so I could write here the pi 1 of M, but they show a little bit more. So the pi 1 of the ball of radius 1 around P, okay, such that the length of the loop is less than epsilon. So the subgroup of the fundamental group of the unit ball generated by small loops contains a nilpotent subgroup n of index bounded above by Cn and of length, I defined this in the first lecture, of length less than n. N is a dimension here. Okay, so such that the index in gamma epsilon de p of p n is less than c of n, and the length of n is less than n, the dimension. Okay, that is a statement. So this statement was it was a question posed by Gromov in the first edition of the Green Book. Okay, so let me just sketch the idea of the proof of this theorem, and I hope I will be able to show you where the rescaling theorem and the short basis theorem enter this picture, because we spent some time on this. Okay, so I will need some notation. So I will call. Z twiddle, the universal cover of the unit ball. Okay. And for any subgroup gamma in the fundamental group of the unit ball, I will call X the quotient of Z twiddle by this group, okay, and I will call P twiddle and P hat the corresponding points in Z twiddle and P hat in X, okay, lift above P, okay, and okay, so this is for the notation, and as you can guess, the proof of the theorem is by contradiction. And so you have to write what in this case is a contradicting sequence. So you assume by contradiction that there exists a sequence of such manifold such that gamma I, which will be the subgroup of generated by element of the fundamental group of the ball centered at pi of length at pi less than, say, 2 to the minus I. So if there is no such constant, then I will be able to find a sequence of manifold such that this subgroup do not contain any nilpotent subgroup of index less than 2 to the I and length less than n. Okay? So this is exactly what is a sequence which violates the conclusion of the theorem. Okay? And then we... So the proof will essentially say that, assuming that you have this, then you can find, after suitable rescaling, another sequence, which in fact will at the end, after some I, for I large enough, will contain some nilpotent subgroup of length less than n, and with finite index. Okay, so let me just do it now. So first of all, we consider xi to be zi twiddle quotiented by gamma I. Okay, and of course, I can assume. So this is gamma I is a subgroup which contradicts the conclusion of the theorem, and then I just consider the covering of the ball associated to this subgroup. Okay, and of course, I can assume that it is converging to some space. Okay, to some metric space, and I will first. Okay, so what I know about this is that gamma I is generated by element, of course, of length less than 2 to minus I, okay, and satisfy the condition star. And what is the condition star? It is this condition here, okay? Okay, so we have this, and so we did it several times. So we can first of all reduce, so renormalize slowly this sequence of spaces in such a way that I converge to some tangent cone of this space at some regular points. So now you get used to this trick, and then the first reduction is to deduce from this that there exists some lambda I slowly tending to infinity, such that lambda I xi converges to some RK, to some Euclidean space, okay? And still satisfies And the group still satisfies the condition star, just because the loops were tending to zero. The generator of the group at length tending very rapidly to zero, and then if I take sufficiently slow renormalizing coefficient, then I will certainly be able to say that not satisfy star, but is generated. Maybe it's generated by element of length, say, bounded. Okay. So the first generator had very small length, and with the renormalized thing, so I go sufficiently small, slowly, so that it stays bounded. Okay. Okay. And then the contradiction will come from the following theorem. So up to now, it's okay. Just a kind of logical argument. And okay, so now the contradiction will come from the following theorem. So there are two theorems which are very similar, but let me just formulate this one. So one has the sequence xi pi. So since we have renormalized already one time, then the Ricci curvature of this sequence here renormalized. So xi is just lambda I xi, so the Ricci curvature tends to zero, means the lower bound tends to zero. Okay, so we have this. So this is because of renormalization. And let's assume that xi pi converges to Rk, let's say, product with some compact metric space, and that assume this, and assume that the fundamental group of xi pi is generated by loops of length less than, say, constant, then pi 1 of m I pi for large I contains a nilpotent subgroup and of index less than some constant. So what I say here is that there exists some constant which will depend on the so of course I didn't say it, but so it's xi here, and it's not exactly xi, but some subsequence. Of course, each time I have to extract subsequences. So then this is a subsequence. It's not true, of course, for all the sequence. And what I say is that for some subsequence, then the pi 1 contains a nilpotent subgroup of finite index, and the index here will depend on the subsequence. It's not a universal constant, but it's enough to make the contradiction. Okay, and length less than n. Okay. So the idea is that now you are convinced that this theorem certainly gives a contradiction. Okay. Because in the same time, I know that the fundamental group, so I apply this theorem to the lambda I xi here, which we are here, okay? And we know that this group here, upstairs, we know that this group doesn't contain, okay, so maybe I should have written again here. And gamma I does not contain a nilpotent subgroup of index less than 2 to the I and length less than n. Okay? So this statement gives a contradiction, and I think I have written it not correctly. And the length in this case, when you converge to Rk, you can say that the length is less than n minus k. Okay.
Okay. No condition.
It's just some compact metric space. Okay. So in order to get the contradiction, I will apply this theorem for k equal a point. Okay. But in order to show this theorem, I need k. Because I will again do an argument by induction of the dimension, so I have to include it in the statement. Sorry. So okay, right. So it is in the case. So this statement, this theorem here was proved by Kapovich Tushman and Petronin, under the assumption that the Ricci curvature, the sectional curvature, was bounded below by minus one, so stronger assumption, and they get the same conclusion without optimality on the length and without uniform bound on the. But the proof is the same. What is simple? So the structure of the proof is the same. It's an argument by contradiction, and the part which is really simpler is the rescaling theorem. So when you have a lower bound on a sectional curvature, if you have a sequence of manifold which converge to R to the Euclidean space of dimension strictly lower, then you do have a fibration. So you don't need a rescaling theorem. So you do have a Yeah. And so it's much simpler for this reason. But the structure of the proof is the same. It's not constructive. It's by contradiction and so on. Okay. Okay. So this is a theorem one has to prove. Okay. And in fact, for some reason, which I hope will appear clear in at the end of the proof, not right now. What Kapovich and Wilking prove is not exactly this theorem, but some statement which seems to be a little bit more complicated. Okay, so this is the theorem B. The theorem B says almost the same thing. So Xi, Pi, a sequence of manifold with Ricci almost on positive. And you suppose that it converges to Rk cross K. And that pi 1 of Xi is generated by loops of length less than R. And then you add something which will seem now mysterious, and which you can forget but I will write it down, but you can forget this. So, and you add this mysterious thing, so you have a family of diffeomorphism, of k diffeomorphism, from mi pi to mi pi. So they exist. You assume that there exists such a family of diffeomorphism. So these are diffeomorphism. And these diffeomorphism have the zooming in properties that I mentioned yesterday, but I didn't define it, so that's why you certainly can forget this at the moment. So satisfying the zooming in property, what I called asymptotically isometric at all scales yesterday. So satisfying some properties, so forget about it for now. And these diffeomorphisms are supposed, so they are defined at the level of the universal cover. And you assume that they normalize pi 1 of xi pi, okay? So they come from downstairs for all g. And then the conclusion. Then the conclusion is roughly the same, but you will add to the conclusion some information to this thing, and you will see how one uses to do the proof of this theorem by induction. So let me just write down first the statement and then discuss a little bit. Then there exists some constant C, such that for I large enough, then pi 1 of xi pi contains a nilpotent subgroup. N of index not more than C, and such that those F, J, I, and here also you can forget it at the moment, so to certain power, which is C factorial, but never mind, such that these guys let the cyclic nilpotent sequence of n invariant. Okay, so I should say nilpotent group of length less than n minus k. Okay, and so n being of length less than n minus k means that there exists a sequence of normal subgroup of n of length n minus k, at most n minus k, such that the quotient is cyclic. Okay, and what I mean by preserving this sequence for the f, for this diffeomorphism, means that it preserves by conjugation the group are preserved. Okay, and so n and j are invariant. So here I explain this part of the sentence. N j is are invariant under f j I to this strange power, and the action induced by this diffeomorphism on the quotient is trivial. Okay, it acts as identity. So forget about this. At the moment it's not very important. We will see it appear in a while. Okay. Let me just make a comment. So it seems that you could find this statement much more complicated than this one because of the introduction of this diffeomorphism. So why do we introduce this diffeomorphism? Do they introduce this diffeomorphism at this place? It's because the idea of the proof of this is to make some reverse induction argument on K. Okay, we are going to say that if k is equal to n, then as in the short basis theorem, it will be trivial because of the fact that large balls here are trivial, so there are no group. Okay, so we are going to make an argument by induction, by reverse induction on k, and that in order to pass from k to k plus 1 in this induction argument, that we need this. And you will see this in a while. Okay, so let me just let the statement as it is. Any questions so far? So I'm conscious that there is some mysterious part here, but yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So these are diffeomorphisms. Say it again. So
this is a map from xi to up to x.
Ah, yeah, right. Okay, so I have mixed up the notation. Sorry. So yeah, right. So I should say for my notation, it was z twiddle I and z twiddle I. Okay. So universal cover of xi. Okay. Sure. Thank you. Okay, so now let me just sketch the proof of the theorem B. So it will be really sketchy, but okay, so so we prove sketch of proof. I forgot to say that theorem B trivially implies theorem A, just choosing the diffeomorphism to be identity. Okay. Because this is just something that I have added to theorem A. So, okay. So, so the sketch of proof of theorem B. So, you have Xi with fundamental group gamma I. Okay, and I know that. Okay, so I know that. Xi I know that gamma I is generated by loops of length less than R, and so I can apply the short basis theorem. So I can say now that this group is generated by bounded number of generators. So I take, so I can take a short basis, or I can choose a short basis of gamma I, so which I denote gamma 1 I, gamma 2 I, etc., gamma sigma I. Okay, and because of the short basis theorem, there is a fixed number sigma. I extract the subsequent, so this sigma is constant. Okay, and I have finitely many such generators. And let me just introduce some notation. So I will call, so gamma I is a group generated by gamma A, gamma 1, I, etc., gamma sigma I. And I will call, okay, so let me just say something now. So for gamma I, one has a finite family of generators. Some of them will have a length which tends to zero, some of them not. So what it is easy to check is that there exists some epsilon and some epsilon I tending to zero, such that if I look at the length of those generators, of the sequence of generators, then one has the following picture. So one has gamma I less than gamma tau I less than epsilon I. So there are, I want to make the distinction between those generators whose length tends to zero and the other one, okay? And then there exists some epsilon here. So here is gamma tau. And then I come up to gamma sigma I. Okay? And so maybe the group is entirely here, maybe the group is entirely here. All cases are possible, okay? But I have this kind of dichotomy. And now I will consider gamma I, and I will consider gamma I hat, which is the subgroup of gamma I generated by all generators except the last one. And I will also look at the subgroup of this one, which is gamma I epsilon, which is generated by the small generators. So gamma 1 I, gamma 2 I. Okay, the one which tends to 0. Okay? So now one has the, let me just draw some heuristic picture of what is going on. So once again, so one has a sequence of manifold with fundamental group gamma I, which converges to, I recall you that this converges to RK cross K, and I have finite, and the group is generated by loops of bounded length, and so I should have mentioned that this is the length, and this is less than R, and this is the length at PI. Okay, so one has this situation, and so what the example you have to keep in mind is the following. So one wants to show that gamma is nilpotent, and he has this subgroup here. So the ideal picture is the following. So gamma I is is included in the subgroup of gamma I, okay? And here, I would like to so I don't know that gamma I is normal in gamma I hat is normal in gamma I, but I do as if it were the case, okay? And I would have this following picture here, okay? Which in some sense correspond to would correspond to a fibration, so gamma twiddle modulo gamma I hat, and here one has xi, and here one has some manifold xi bar. Okay, so if we knew that xi is fibers over some manifold with fibers this, we would have that one has such a sequence of short sequence of subgroup, and the example you can keep in mind is the following example. You could imagine that gamma I is just R3. It's a stupid example, but it's good to have it in mind. R3, let's say, divided by epsilon z plus epsilon square z plus z, for example. Okay, so the fiber would be, for example, the fiber would be R3 divided by epsilon z plus epsilon square z, and downstairs R3 divided by z, okay? And, okay, this is a picture you have in mind, and the idea is is the following. So we want to show that this guy here is virtually nilpotent. Okay? And the idea is to show that this group is virtually nilpotent from the fact that this one will be virtually nilpotent by some induction hypothesis. So this will be virtually nilpotent. And the quotient here would be abelian, okay? So this is the scheme of the proof. So what we are going to, what we want to show is that this group here is normal in this one, and this one is virtually nilpotent for some induction hypothesis, and the quotient is abelian, and so it's which means that gamma I is some kind of nilpotent extension of an abelian group, which is not enough to show that gamma I is nilpotent. It could be solvable, so there is something more to be shown, but it is the idea. So gamma I will be shown to be virtually nilpotent as a nilpotent, virtually nilpotent extension of some abelian group. Okay, so this is the idea, and And time is running, so let me just state some facts and show you how all this is working. So there are a few. Okay, so let me just make another comment. So, of course, all what I am saying here is true in this trivial example, and the difficulty in this statement is one of the difficulties of the statement is that we don't start with a fixed manifold with a fixed topology and a fixed vibration structure. We don't have this. We have just a sequence of group with some properties, and we want to kind of reconstruct this kind of vibration structure. So that's why it's, I mean, the manifold XI have absolutely no reason to be the same topologically. It's just a sequence, okay? So it's, of course, it's much more complicated than in the example, of course. And let me just state a few claims. So, I am looking at the theorem B, okay? And I just, in the theorem B, I claim that we can assume, and I will say a few words at the end why it's possible to do this. We can assume that FJI, this diffeomorphism, tend to identity. So forget about this because I didn't tell you what really those diffeomorphisms are. You will see this in a moment. We can assume that the diameter of K is positive. Okay, so I recall you that XI PI is converging to RK product K. So in this assumption, in theorem B, we can assume that we can reduce to the case where the diameter of K is positive. And the third claim is that we can assume that the subgroup gamma I epsilon generated by the loops which tends to zero is normal in gamma I and therefore with abelian quotient and the quotient is abelian and therefore gamma hat also is normal in gamma I, okay? So these are the three claims. Of course, this has to be shown, but okay, let me just conclude from these claims and then say a few words about these facts here. So as you see, we really, this assumption is the one I wanted here, okay? And okay, so I should maybe have said, and I will do it now. So I said it, but maybe I should say it again. So we prove theorem B. So I said it, but I didn't write it down. So by reverse induction on K, okay, this is the argument, okay, and which means that, okay, so maybe I should have said before. So if K equal n, then we are done because of the trigger coding. So if k is equal to n, so one has xi pi converging to Rn, okay, you cannot have a compact factor because a non-trivial compact factor because dimension is n, and and so by trigger coding, we know that balls of radius R in MI, in XI, are diffeomorphic to Euclidean ball, which implies that the pi 1 of XI is trivial, so there is nothing to be proved. Okay? And so the argument goes as follows. So you assume that that theorem B is proved for all k prime less than or equal to n, and you prove it, and you want to prove it for k. Okay, this is the idea, okay? All right, so one has our, so we argue by contradiction. See, if it's not true for k, one has this sequence of xa, which converges to rk cross k, okay? And I look at a short basis, and I construct all this group, gamma I epsilon, gamma I hat, okay? And the idea is to say that this is impossible because, not that it's impossible, but the idea is now to show that from this assumption, the fundamental group of Xi contains a nilpotent subgroup of finite index. Okay, so, all right, so, okay, so we have our sequence xi, pi, which converges to rk cross k. And I want to conclude that the fundamental group of xi contains nilpotent subgroup of finite index and of length less than n minus k from the fact that I know it is true for any other situation where the limit is rk plus something, okay? All right, so the first reduction, other reduction, is that we can assume that the index of gamma I epsilon in gamma I tends to infinity. Okay? So, okay, one has this family of these three subgroups of gamma I, gamma I hat, and gamma I epsilon, and I claim that we can assume that taking a subsequence, that this index tends to infinity, because if not, this means that this index would be bounded, okay? And then you would replace gamma I by gamma I epsilon. You don't care because you are looking for nilpotent subgroup of finite index. Then replace gamma I by gamma I epsilon, okay? But now, and replace xi by zi twiddle divided by quotient by gamma I epsilon, okay? But now this group is generated by very small element. And then you can rescale slowly and since this group is generated by very small element, you can rescale in such a way that again the group is generated by element of bounded size, okay? And so it will converge to in such a way that the rescale, so this guy were converging to is converging to RK cross K, and you can rescale since K is not a point, the diameter is positive. You can rescale in such a way that you converge to RK cross some tangent cone to K, and which gives rise to some other extra dimension. Okay. And then you can apply the induction assumption to prove that this group now contains a nilpotent subgroup of finite index with all good properties and therefore you are done because this subgroup was a finite index, this group was a finite index subgroup of gamma I, so you are done. So this is the first reduction, and the second reduction is the following. So you can assume that the index, so it means that there are there are not only small generators, but there are also generators which do not tend to zero. And the second reduction is that we can assume that the index of gamma I hat in gamma I also tends to infinity. Because if it is not the case, so I recall you that one has gamma 1 I, gamma tau I, gamma tau plus 1 I, gamma sigma I, okay, and that gamma hat is generated by this generator. So if this subgroup is not of finite, is not of index tending to infinity in the large one, you just replace gamma I by gamma I hat, as before. And since you already know that the index of the full group, so this is here, this is gamma I epsilon, since you know that the index of the full group of this group in the large one tends to infinity because of the first reduction, you know that at some point you will have a new gamma I hat with index tending to infinity. Okay, it stops. This replacement stops at some point, okay? Then take it again, make it again. And it stops because gamma I, the index of gamma I epsilon and gamma I tend to infinity. Okay? So we can assume that gamma I divided by gamma hat as cardinal tends to infinity, and then we look at the following. So what do we have? Maybe I can write here. I have just 5 minutes to conclude, it's a bit short. So what do we have? So what do we have? We have that, so we have this situation. So we have the initial group, gamma I, acting on ZI twiddle, which were converging to RK cross RL cross some K2 P twiddle infinity and with some limit group action, and one has the same situation with the subgroup gamma I hat, which converge to the same space, but with a different limit group. Okay, and then the how can we use what we have done so far? So first of all, we know that gamma I hat is normal here, and so one has an action of gamma I modulo gamma I hat on this space on Z, so on X I hat, which is Zi twiddle modulo gamma I hat. Okay, this group acts on this quotient, okay, and this action do converge to the action of G modulo G hat on the quotient of Rk cross RL cross K2 divided by G hat, okay, which is, let's say, X hat. Okay, and okay. So now the fact that the index of gamma I hat here tends to infinity, so the cardinal of this tends to infinity, tells you that the action of this group on this space has a non-compact orbit. So here, we have reduced to the case where the index of gamma I hat in gamma I tends to infinity, and just believe me, that this implies that the action of this group on the limited space has a non-compact orbit, and this implies that if you look at xi hat, then the limit. So which has fundamental group gamma I hat, it is converging to Rk plus p, so cross Rp with p positive cross k2. Okay. And then we can use induction assumption and say that this group is virtually nilpotent. And it is the first step of my argument, and then one has to work again to conclude. But okay, so what I have done so far, it's not exactly the proof of I didn't go up to the end, but I am at the point where now gamma is virtually nilpotent. Thanks to the induction assumptions. And then it's not that hard to conclude that gamma I is nilpotent, is virtually nilpotent with a finite index. And okay, so maybe I should stop here because it's time, but okay, so I stop here.